professor, he's associate professor, Christopher Schneiders. Now, everyone does refer to him as Chris. And Chris works in a multicultural environment. He's based in Perth some of the time. He teaches at the IE Business School with postgrad students in Madrid. And then he whips across to Europe, both to Holland and across to his, has a client in Warsaw, where he works in the corporate level. And he does a lot of coaching, but with practical experiential facilitation of executives in a holistic sense, using a whole lot of techniques and styles of work. In Perth, he tends to these days work as a clinical hypnotherapist and a psychotherapist, and he taps all of the alternative healing modalities as well as the academic. And he's an intuitive person, so he tends to read the need at the time and work from there. And in the business environment, that can always pose challenges, but Chris has the personality to overcome that very quickly. I'm going to get you all to give Chris a huge round of applause, and we'll get him to the stage.
Oh yeah, now it works. It will take 1 minute, okay? Looking if my first slide is still on. Welcome everybody, and sorry I was just running in. I'm Dutch, I love to be in time. I said to everybody, 2:40 we start. And it's 2:30 I came aware. And I have to put this one here, otherwise you don't hear me. That's okay. It will come up. So I just have a question before we start. On a scale from 1 to 10, and 10 is the pulp on being Prozac, totally extremely happy, and 1 is where's the next train I can jump in front of, and everything in between, how would you rate yourself on happiness, on contentment? I asked the same question yesterday in my workshop, and up to now I never saw somebody say, I'm a 10. Isn't it amazing? There's a 10. I know her. She knows the answer. Yeah. But most of us, we are born almost in an extreme happy state. I just saw outside there a little baby smiling and cuddly and whatever. And then we're all grown ups, and somewhere we blame life that we're not happy anymore. Yeah! Hey, little one. And I love that statement, although it's really an NLP statement, neuro-linguistic programming. Let's be creative. Now I can see it a little bit better, because some people, what's under there? I know it's now somewhere in that, whatever kind of thing it is. The speaker, thanks myself, what is it, the speaker? There are limitations, they're only in our mind. And you are, by the way, amazing. Who agrees or doesn't agree that all your limitations are actually in your mind or in your body? Because if we all had amnesia and would not know our name anymore, or if we're our gender, 99.9% of our issues were gone. The only reason we have them is because we hold back, and we love to hold them. And we like to blame everybody else for our partly bad life. So I'm really welcome to this experimental workshop. Why experimental? Because I never know what's going to happen. I presented the whole slide pack. Sometimes I do, sometimes I don't, because you're the most important here. And this is just to help me if I get speechless. I'm really grateful to meet you. Some people I saw before. I'm extremely horrendous in names, but good in faces. So, oh yes, saw those people. And for the next 45 minutes, I send you all my love and energy to make this an amazing moment. Time. I love strong statements, life will never be the same. And it's actually true, because every inhale and exhale we take, already at least 20 million body cells are changed. We rejuvenate on an enormous speed. So you're never the same. It does not reveal my age, but I love the number 5 billion. So if you're 47 years old, you lived already 5 billion seconds. How did you live them? Yeah, I know. Some people I think, oh, that hurts. I know. That's why I say don't reveal my age, because then I'd have to do the math again. How did you live those moments? And most people will live those moments on automatic control. They don't know what they were had for dinner 2 days ago or 3 days ago, because it just lost. Every morning we do our same procedures and waking up, getting our breakfast, getting washed, doing all the stuff, and we don't do them really with a conscious mind. The only thing that is conscious is our time that we have to run for the train or for the car to get to our work, whatever. What's my objective when I came here? At least to make you aware that you are in charge of your own health and happiness. Nobody else. So everybody who says there, take my oils, take my crystals, do whatever they do, is amazing, but you're in charge. Nobody else can change you. You can have assistance, that's all about you. You can sleep on a bed of crystals, having all the essential oils and do amazing hypnotherapy. If you're not open for it, nothing will change. Except that you have a sore back from lying on all the crystals. And don't get me wrong, I have all of them, eh? Not the bed, because I love to have a soft bed. But as long as you're not open for it, nothing will change. And we talk about what kind of 9 steps you actually need to be happy. This is my belief system, besides that I love animals, because animals are the only developed animals in this world who don't know hate or cruelty. We humans are the only people who, or humans or animals, who know the word hate and cruelty. We kill for pleasure. Animals don't. And it starts with compassion and love for me. Because that's the strongest emotion we have, actually. So, I will not ask everybody, otherwise the time is over, but who has a clear objective of what he or can see, there are some he's, or she likes to get out of it. And likes to share that, by the way, because at the moment you speak out, everybody hears. What would you like to get out of today? Do you like to speak it out loud?
Yeah, I'm Virginia, and I'm here to let go. I'm a hoarder, and I have to move. Homes West have asked me, and I'm just interested in everything outside. I love, the world, except my home. I'd love to bring more love into my home, more passion, more organisation. Just to really enjoy being at home and not need to go out all the time to be happy. I'd like to be happy, passionate and loving in my own home and to have people come. Yeah.
That's a beautiful statement, and I think most of us can say, oh wow, I can, at least for parts of them, I like to enjoy those, being happy, finding the home. And for me, when we talk about home, what is home? Is home a house? Is home somewhere there? Or somewhere out there with a lot of music. Happiness, I just put it really quick, because I became aware how actually messed up we are. Every year, 1 million have depression, 2 million have anxiety. We have 24 million people living here. That's an amazing number. 12% of the kids thought about suicide. 4% actually did an attempt. It does not fit in my normal brain. Because it means when I look at this class, this group, almost that side has some or one of those issues. It should only be this person, this empty chair, in my opinion. In relationships, I love that part, being divorced 3 times, so I talk from experience. Yeah, takes a long time to learn. And some people, why do they break up with me now? Run away, that's okay. That's okay. I don't take it personal. Does somebody have some tissues for me, please? I talk about breakups and two people leave already. Most of my relationships stay a little bit longer. Anyhow, 50% breaks up in the first marriage. And the people who stay together, they go, oh, they're perfect. No. 8 out of 10 who stay together are actually not happy together. And they stay together because they have kids, they have finances, they have a house, they have excuses to stay together. So they cheat on each other and don't tell their secrets to each other. Don't start laughing. You're feeling something. 10% or 9% have a good relationship. And that's just a good relationship. And your friends, you have sex together, and you enjoy life, partly. But you do your own things. You don't share everything. And only 1% really has an amazing relationship. Where we go for the movies. We say, oh yes, I'd like to be like that. You see Ryan Gosling in The Notebook, you think, oh yes, I like to. First, all the ladies like to meet Ryan Gosling. I can understand that part. They say, oh yes, I like to have somebody who goes for me like that. And only 1 out of 1,000 have a soulmate relationship. And for me, there's also, that's why I divorced 3 times, staggering numbers. Because why would you stay in an unhappy situation? It's like staying underneath a really cold shower and not enjoying it. Why would you do that? Or in too hot, whatever. Doesn't make sense. I love taking cold showers, but I love it. So let's do a little exercise to change your energy and become aware how much we are in charge. So I don't have to know the answer, but how is your energy? So on a scale from 1 to 10, I love 1 to 10. How's your energy? 10 is that you're almost just like me, jumping around. 1 is I'm sleeping, only I have my eyes open. And everything in between. Now that you have your number, just make, how's your focus? And what I mean with focus is, how much can you focus on what's happening here? Without thinking, what is on Snapchat, Facebook, Instagram, who should I mail, what did my wife say to me, do I have a coffee, where's the tea, I need to go to the bathroom, all the kind of other things we have in our mind. All of them. And I scale 1 and 10. 10 is totally focused. I can really be with my mind here. And 1 is Facebook, Snapchat, Instagram. Oh yes, shit, I didn't look at them. That post right away a picture of me, selfie. And how's your happiness? We already asked that question. Are you, by the way, ready to do something strange? I love strange. Oh, that's good. You know you signed up for now. That's not kidding. What do we need more to solve things? And actually, there's only 1 thing we really need, all of us. That's a friend. That's compassion. That's where I started with. So we're going to do a little exercise just to become aware how it changes your energy and mood set. So please, if you don't have a neighbor, find a neighbor, because some people are on the end of some person. Find somebody behind you, next to you. And you only have to do 3 things. So she volunteered, so I know she volunteered. Don't think, oh wow, you put somebody in. Yes. So I will show you what we're going to do so you really know. So I have to talk in here, otherwise people don't. So you look somebody, you look her in the eyes. Not her, but you look the other person in the eyes. Now you see my butt, I know. Could we turn around, please? It's not my best part. And when you look in the eyes, you say, I'm really grateful to meet you.
I'm really grateful to meet you.
Yeah. I send you love and support.
I send you love and support.
For the next 45 minutes.
For the next 45 minutes.
Yes. Yeah. And after that, you can say thank you or whatever, and you go to the next person if you like to turn around and swap around. Thank you so much. So please do that to your neighbor. Or the neighbor behind you or somebody else. And if you don't have somebody, we can do each other. So I'm not questioning. Some are the same questions, so you know the questions. How's your energy? From a scale from 1 to 10, it's better or worse than 5 minutes ago? How's your focus? Better or worse than 5 minutes ago? And how's your happiness compared to 5 minutes ago? The same. That's okay. Yeah, if it's a 10, you cannot make it. You cannot change. But for most people, they will find a difference. And most times a positive difference. That's a good thing, by the way. So just in 1 or 2 minutes, you can change your own energy, your own focus, your own happiness. The only thing you have to do is to connect to somebody. And just open yourself up for 1 moment to look in somebody's eyes and say, hey, you know, I'm really grateful to meet you. Welcome to this workshop. I'll send you a lot of love and support for the next 45 minutes. Now, why it's so important to look in the eyes? Because the eyes are the mirrors of the soul and we cannot change those. It's also a way of respect where you say, hey, I'm really grateful to meet you. Actually, you say to somebody, I'm not interested in you. Is there somebody more interested? So this shows you have the capacity to change a lot of your internal state. Just to say to somebody, you're grateful to meet them. We need compassion and safety to change. If you like to live an amazing life, you need compassion and you need safety. Without safety, there's no change. So, in the 9 steps to change your life to make an amazing life, it took me only 30 years to develop this, so it's rather annoying that I think 30 years. So. But I tested it with a lot of my clients, patients, coaches, trainings I did over the world. If it's really true, why a change program works and doesn't work in the company world, in the business world. Why a client or patient did or did not change. And it makes sense, we have to know an awareness about our life, satisfaction and unsatisfaction. Because just imagine what this beautiful Virginia said, I like to be happy. What do we actually know about happiness? What does happy mean? I don't know. It's a huge word. Happy can be the coffee I just had, can be the chocolate brownie that's still waiting for me there. And I'm not going to share. Happiness can be having a beautiful partner and kids around. Happiness can be the sun that is shining in the morning. I'm coming from Holland, so the sun is for me a beautiful gift. We have to be aware of it, but also in concrete terms. What is it actually that makes me tick and doesn't tick? And then actually, what do you do to make it happen? And how does it make you feel? Where do you feel it in your body? Sometimes, yeah, I feel it somewhere. Where do you feel it? In your throat? In your heart? Yes, in your heart. Or in your gut? Of course, we have three brains. We touch on that later. There one, and there one. And the third thing we need awareness of is that we can change. You just showed yourself already you have the capacity to change. You have the resource to change. Create your focus, your happiness, your energy level within 1 minute. So just imagine that you would spend more time in it. You can almost do everything. After the awareness, you need an understanding. How your heart, head, gut brain works. We'll do that after this. I'll show you what it really means. Because we can change logically here. That's why I go to psychologist, counselor and those kind of things. We can change or solve PTSD, or post-traumatic stress syndrome in the head by CBT, cognitive behavior therapy, and actually still be totally messed up here. I do a lot of trauma work. I don't say I love trauma, because that sounds rather horrendous, but I love to solve it. From sexual abuse to what kind of horrendous things. And it's never about how we think about it, how we feel about it somewhere there. And then the most important thing is that you're safe. It sounds strange, but based on what happened in us, we don't feel safe enough to let go of what we always do and to take a step to the new step, to the new world. Some people stay in a situation because that's what they know. And going in that new state is scary. So you need safety. That's why you also need compassion. And safety does not mean that somebody's going to shoot your head off, but safety means I can trust myself. And really trust yourself. Just ask the question to yourself. How much do you really trust yourself on a scale from 1 to 10? I will not ask you to raise hands who says a 10, because then you could be shocked. Because in most classes, only 50% or less dares to share their hand. I trust myself completely. Most people even don't trust themselves. For whatever reason. Most become aware those old emotions we have and old beliefs We don't need them anymore. They were made up for a good reason in the past. I've been bullied when I was young. Being the kid, they kicked the shit out of me. I can now laugh about it. In that moment, not to be honest. I could cry about it. So I learned not to trust. Because you never know if your friend is going to kick you or not. So I have a second radar that I know what's happening there. My kids don't like that because I always see everything. But I had to learn those old emotions were extremely good there and those beliefs. But as an adult, nobody's going to kick my butt anymore. So it's now good to let those old beliefs behind. But if you have them for 40 years, it's hard to let them go. Because they're part of me. And actually say, that is what I am. No, no, that's what I learned. Because going back to the little baby, nobody's born like that. except some situations where you have drug addict parents, those kind of horrendous things. And then we go to the solutions. Step 7, finally. And that's actually letting go. And that's, it sounds so easy, step 7, but it's really letting go. And that's where most people fail, because they don't hold them. Everybody likes to get rid of pain. But the only way to get rid of pain is to become part of your pain. I will not squeeze somebody here as an example, because that is not a wise thing. But the moment you push in somebody, we like to go away. We like to tense our muscle. That only makes the pain worse. You have to go into the pain to get it to let it go. Most people have a negative experience, don't like to be remembered of it. They store it away in a little box, do the box, put it on a key, throw away the key. So how can you let go if you put something in a box with a lock on it? You cannot let it go, because you don't even hold it. That doesn't mean you have to relive your trauma, please not. But at least you have to become the owner of it. As I say, welcome it, and then let it go. And then, of course, we need some new beliefs. Because the moment you let something go, most of my clients, coaches, said, oh, I have a void. They look at big eyes and say, I'm lost. Yes, because you lost something that was always guiding you left or right. So what kind of new things would you like to live? And after that, you can be happy. It's only 8 steps. Pretty easy. Actually, it is and it is not. Because somewhere down the line, one of those steps you will fumble and fall. I did them all. I fell off all of them. Yeah, I think. Procrastinated some. Stayed there. But also know you can go beyond them. So you have to have an awareness, as I said. There are a lot of tools for that. Very happy, not happy. I will not show you now, but it's somewhere. Come aware you can change. This is a coding on 190 identical twins. They were split by birth, not for research results. We're not in Germany again. I'm Dutch, so we can make those jokes. I'm partly Jewish, so I'm allowed to make those jokes. My parents would not agree. But when they came aware, that even your fingerprint is almost the same as a twin. But your weight, only 7 out of 10 times is the same. So an identical twin, and still, after 20, 30, 40 years, your weight is different. It's 30% of the chances. Depression only has a correlation of 37%. So even if you're an identical twin, coming from the same DNA, some twins are depressed and some are not. So it's not in your freaking genes. Don't blame your genes for, I have big bones, that's why I'm overweight. No, it's because what you put underneath your mouth. Nobody gets weight issues from inhaling air. Don't give me that crap. There's a reason maybe why we eat. Literally most females who I meet have sexual abuse, so they use weight as a protection mechanism. So I don't blame them. There's a different kind of reason why they do it. Panic disorders, 35%. That is connected with anxiety. Also nothing. The only thing that's really strong, that's not maybe in here, alcoholism only. Yeah. If you're born Irish or Polish and you saw your parents always drink, yes. Or maybe a West Australian, you have a hard one. It's only 50%. Genes 50%, test the environment 10%, what's around us, and your belief and actions makes 40% of the change. So you can be a 6 and become a 2, or you can be a 6 and become a 10. It's all in your own hands. To become a 2 or a 10 is on your belief and on your actions. Don't blame somebody else. Don't blame yourself, please. Just become aware that you had to do it up to now because it made sense. But it's now time to let it go. Not going to do that. I thought there was head, heart, gut here. Now, I'll just skip the slides where I said we're going to do something. It's much more fun than test how we are depressed. I'll do control B, so this is black. Yeah. We're going to do a beautiful exercise. To become aware how your beautiful head, heart, gut, brain makes a difference. Because we have 100 billion brain cells here. We men have less and they work less, but don't tell anybody. We have 100,000 brain cells in our heart. Really, 20 years ago, a neuroscientist, really, after cutting up, became aware we have the same neurostructure here as there. And he officially declared it's brain, because it can store memory and it can make actions. Here, you have 500 million brain cells. That's the same size as the brain of your cat. Don't tell your dog. And it can store memories and it can take actions. And actually, more evidence is shown that based on the polyvagal nerve, it goes up. 90% of communication goes up, and that your gut brain actually is taking actions. And a Russian researcher said already 70 years ago, this brain is developed because this brain needed a second hand. And so, okay, let's put a huge database there that can just store all those memories where I can take action. So how does it work? It's extremely easy. You can do it all together, because then people don't feel rather exposed. Because that's one of the biggest fears we have, is being exposed or having a speech or those kind of things. So I did it yesterday partly. I'll ask you to do it again. And just imagine, how do you like to be a volunteer again? Now I show you, because then you can see what's happening. And I'm in charge of it. That's also good. Just so that everybody knows, what's your name again?
Virginia. I'm Virginia. Hi, everyone.
Virginia. You're born and raised as Virginia, or Virginia is a name you received later?
I was born Virginia. I'm Lithuanian. When I came to Australia, it became Virginia.
I knew that because I met her earlier. So what I will ask you, are you right or left-handed?
Right-handed,
okay. That's this one. So I will ask Virginia to put her two fingers, say, on their third eye, and say, please, in English, my name is Virginia.
My name is Virginia.
Okay. How does your head respond? And if you don't know, then just say it again.
So
what? If you don't know how your head responded, then just close your eyes for 1 second and say, my name is Virginia.
My name is Virginia.
Okay. And how does your head respond on that?
What does it say?
It doesn't know.
That's great. That's your own name, so it's okay. And please, could you push your two fingers on your heart? That's the only moment I don't touch anybody somewhere anymore. And please, could you do the same? And sometimes easy to close your eyes because you can really come aware inside. And say, my name is Virginia.
My name is Virginia. Because it doesn't feel right.
Doesn't feel right. I love your your feeling. Could you put your finger, say, just around your soft spot underneath your navel? That's a soft spot, also for me. And say it again. My name is Virginia.
My name is Virginia.
How is it there?
There's hesitation.
Isn't that beautiful? Thank you so much. This is her own name. Please stay, because we're going to do something else. That her three brains react actually differently. So this is what words do and how we connect with our own name. Do you still speak your native language?
Yes.
Thanks. So I will ask you to say your own name in your own native language. So we don't understand, I don't understand it, but doesn't matter. Yeah. And when you do that, please put your two fingers in. Say. No, you don't have to do that.
Virginia.
My name is Virginia, and then in your own language.
Okay, my name is Virginia.
And now in your own language.
Manovardas era Virginia.
And how is that for you?
I'm feeling tightness.
Okay, and really focus on your head and say it just once again and say.
My name is Virginia.
No, really in original language.
Manovardas era Virginia.
Okay, and how does it feel there?
There's still confusion.
Okay, still confused, okay. Could you please put your hands on your heart? I say in Ukrainian again.
Manovardas era Virginia, and that feels so beautiful.
What you just said.
It just feels so right.
It's all right. Thank you so much. Could you please put your hands, your fingers there, and say do the same?
It just feels so right.
Thank you so much for coming up here. And by the way, I know also the answer on your question you had here. Can you sit down? So give her applause, because it's easy for me to stand up here, because that's, let's say, my second nature, but somebody comes up and is so open and dares to show for that. So on your question, I like to find home. You right away know the answer why you don't find home. And we can work on that, but that's not for now. But right away come aware the heart doesn't feel home. Actually, the emotion stays in the old country. So when she, whatever moved, for whatever reason, everything, she lost a part of herself. That's my first initial. And she agrees. That's good. Not for me, good, but it's good for her, because then I have somewhere in awareness. So what I like you to do, and you can also do it in couples, because that's why I showed you. Are you okay? That's okay. I'll invite you to do the same with your neighbor. And why with your neighbor? Because you can just write it. And just use your own name. And if you don't have a native name or a nickname, just use a fake name. Just do Donald Trump, Ivanka Trump, Julia Gillard, Beyoncé, Justin Bieber, I don't know, Eminem. Choose somebody. It doesn't matter. Because I like that you test your real name and your fake name. And really ask to say that my name is now Christopher. And just come aware what's there happening. My name is Christopher. Come aware what's there happening. My name is Christopher, come aware what's there happening. So ask the question every time after you say a name, what's happening there? Don't let them do all three and then come aware, because they don't know what's happening. And your own name, because that's what you used to, so it should be true. And a nickname, you come aware how it feels on different levels when you say something not true. So you come aware how actually your brains are actually communicating. And the first step of healing yourself, of being happy, is actually come aware where you got stuck or not got stuck. Because then we know how I can help this beautiful lady. Because I know she's not stuck there. She already said she was stuck there, but she's also stuck in her gut, and your gut is survival instinct. So as long as you don't create that safety over here, she will never feel home here. She not only have to work on the heart, but also on the gut part. So I would say have fun with this. Choose somebody. And play with it. If you have a question, just walk around while I find the slides where it was written down. And if you like the sentence, it's there up. I found them. Yeah, I took this away, otherwise everybody hears me. Good, you're following me with the camera. I know I walk around. Amazing, yes. I thought I would just walk around to see how people are doing or they have questions. Yes, of course.
I was raised right-handed, so
I don't know. I don't know what you are. You can choose both of them. You come aware how it feels for you, versus no right and wrong. You just come aware, hey, I feel different when I say it in English or say it in my other kind of language. No. Did you choose the hand? That's more you use always. If you're right, you use right hand. If you're left, you use your left hand. And don't change your hands, because then the energy can flow a different way. You get different kind of answers. Always use the same hand. So it's a good question.
Yeah,
Yes, because the energy flows.
It's a hand that I usually use.
Yes, it's the strongest, because that's the strongest hand.
But my strongest is my left.
Then you can use your left, you can see what's different.
Right.
Okay, then you can also use left. She's complicated, but I think you knew already. Now you can use both, but always use the same hand.
Okay.
Like I'm a lefty, so I always use left, but I know most people are right. Because actually, it's the shortest way from the heart to the left hand. So the left hand is stronger connected with the heart than the right. But if you use always right, you're more in tuned to your right hand. That's why I say most use the hand that's more dominant. So you can use both and just change what the difference is.
Okay.
Thank you. So I come aware that I saw tears, I saw emotions, I saw a lot of things. And when there's nothing, it's still okay. In both times there were nothing?
Nowhere.
Nowhere. You never do. With your own name or with a fake name you didn't do?
My own name.
With your own name. It was a fake name. Did you have a response? Beyoncé, Julia Gillard, Ivanka Trump, Christopher Snyders. He's totally strange. Okay, didn't try. Now, so why I asked that, when you use your own name, most times the response is more neutral. Because that's where we're used to. So there's not a really emotional connection with it. That's why I say, when the moment you use a fake name, that can be a nickname or can be really a fake name, there will be another kind of emotion because your head or your heart or your gut will say, that's not me. And if you have a dislike about it, per se I would say Donald Trump, probably I had to run to the bathroom within 2 minutes. Or probably sooner. Depends how long I can stand like this. Because I have a huge emotion with that guy. And so that's why I say also use your own name because you know it's true, and a fake name because then you come aware that it's not true. And if you had a nickname like this beautiful Polish lady and you start talking in Polish, it has a different kind of emotion. As you just saw with Virginia. Because you used that name when you were born and your parents called you like that in that language. So it's a different kind of emotion to that than the emotion we have here. So when we talk about issues, and it was before that, we have a head, heart and gut. And somewhere in there, there's a solution in the issue on the same moment. And how do we keep issues alive? Because we think about what will happen in the future. How will they perceive me? Say I do different. How will they perceive me if I say to my parents, hey, by the way, I'm going to be divorced for the third time. How will they respond on that? I knew their response, but I can. So based on that fear I could have, I could stay in there. How do I think about it? Do I care or don't care about what my parents think about it? I didn't, so that makes life easier. But you can think about it. Do you make it black and white? Yeah? People are really in the church. Divorce is a sin. If you're Catholic, you cannot marry it for the second time. As Polish people know.
51 years.
51 years, wow. Okay. I have to learn from you. Or think about things like that past. That's not fair. It should not have happened to me. Why this? You only can have depression if you think about the past. I like to change the past. So then we start with the belief systems and justice system and values that connect us. The moment you think what happened to me is not fair, that's a justice system, it's hard to let go. So when my second wife ran away after half a year of immigration with a firefighter, a real story, having sex in our just built house when I was in Sydney, I had some issues with my justice system. I don't know why. It took me, I think, 1 year to get over that partly. Because that should not have happened to me. That she betrayed me is okay, but not in our house. With her sentence, we did not do it in our bed. That meant everybody, everywhere else. So it took me a long, long, long time. I can now laugh about it, but depression, anxiety, and all the other kind of things, I know them. By heart, I can tell you. Because it was not fair. Until the moment I changed my justice system, I could let it go. I had to welcome it that it just happened. But the more I think about it, it just stays in my life. The exercise behaviors can help or not help it. Start playing sad music. Where do broken hearts go? Nah, okay, where are the tissues? looking at your old pictures. Oh, that's where we got married. Oh, that's no, that doesn't help you to get over it. It's good for the Kleenex and the tissues. It helps a lot. It doesn't help. Or what we do to resolve the pain, drugs, and all this kind of crap. It doesn't help. I don't do that, but it doesn't help. A bottle of wine is great, but the next day you regret it. This is I regret it. And then we can have bodily, we can have energy systems in our body. We can feel a sore neck, a sore hip. We can store the energy somewhere. Because the energy gets somewhere stored. Some people do a physiotherapy massage or chiropractors. And why is that? Because the energy is blocked. So when you work on issues or on happiness, you have to look at all of them. Where actually is it manifesting? And how can we let go of that? It's not so easy, I always say. But they all are somewhere connected. I love that. When we make emotional decisions, extremely happy or extremely sad, you'll have emotional outcomes. Or too optimistic, or too negative. Well, this will never happen. No. You make a decision on that, and it will never happen. The moment you start believing it, it could happen. The same if you are totally rational, you're only in your head. Let's put it in an Excel sheet. Let's put my force relationship in an Excel sheet. If she ticks all the boxes, sizes, education, wealth, that doesn't work. I tell you that one. That's a rational decision, doesn't work. They have a rational outcome. It doesn't work. Because then the heart doesn't feel. And so actually you have to align all your three brains to really live a happy and healthy life. That's what you just tested out. You have to connect the head, the heart, and the gut to really come aware where is it happening or not happening. Now we did this one. That was later. Came aware it was later. And then one last thing. On everything that we once learned, we create a belief. We believe eating an apple is healthy. We believe 8 hours of sleep is good. This, by the way, it's a fact partly, but we still believe it. We believe we're morning persons or evening persons. We believe whatever we believe. We believe there's a God, there's no God. We believe we can change, we cannot change. We can believe we can be healthy, not healthy. And we hold them in our head, our heart, and our gut. So all the beliefs we like to change are also somewhere stored. I can believe here, I can do this. And my heart says, no, 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 no. You're not worth it, Chris. You messed up so many things, you're not worth it. And my gut says, that's not a safe thing to do, by the way, Chris. Are you stupid? You already dislocated your shoulder 3 times. Don't do those kind of things. And how do we learn them? Traumas, even if they're minor. If you got beaten up when you were young, you learn some beliefs. When your girl runs away, or when I love to dance, and when I was 17 on a dance school, being a great dancer, at least in my perception, I never forget one of the girls said, you're really amazing. The only thing I really like about you are your teeth. Yes. Yeah, it is really true, by the way. You can laugh about it. One, I'm extremely precious about my teeth, because that's the only thing that people love. Secondly, it's not good for your self-esteem. And so somebody, I created the belief, okay, I should at least smile to people. They see my best asset. It's really true. And you can learn it from TV. Look at Big Bang or whatever. They're sad. What does Penny do when she's sad? Whoop, start drinking. So we think drinking is a solution for sadness. We learn things from social media. You look at WhatsApp, Facebook, what they do. And you start believing it's true. You know, Penny gets paid $1 million for one episode. Don't believe what they say. They get paid for that. And these kind of beliefs, we all have them somewhere in our heart or mind or gut. I should be perfect or I cannot fail. Perfectionism. Hopefully most girls have that partly. Based on how society portrays women, what they should or shouldn't have, how they should or shouldn't look. My emotions are great indicators for action. So I feel I need the chocolate. For me that's true, by the way. I feel I need the chocolate. I feel and I really need some cheese and some red wine. And my emotions are extremely good deciders on the evening. No, they're not. They just say I'm tired. and I like to indulge myself. I have to avoid rejection. A lot of people are brought up with that idea. It feels pain to feel rejected, so they stay in whatever kind of unhealthy relationship. Or as people. I'm not good enough. No. Raise hands, I would say, who once had that belief. And I think everybody will raise his hand somewhere. Yes, I'm one of them. Because we all had it somewhere. Not good enough. And pitifully, a lot of parents installed it in us. Not because they hate us, but they think it will make us stronger. I cannot do. Or people would put themselves down and not slim, not smart, not attractive, etc., etc., etc. Comes a self-fulfilling prophecy. We're almost done. Yes, life's not fair. So, I know by heart I shouldn't push too much. So when we look how we operate, our deepest emotions, instinct, when you look at little babies around, they seek happiness, belonging, love, and like to avoid pain. Look at the little baby, they smile at you, they like to be cuddled, and they don't like a wet diaper. And when they have pain, they just start screaming. Later in life, we learn values from our parents. We learn passion, trust, sadness, anger, certainness. And most of us cannot declare them anymore. We need to learn to trust, not to trust. It happens most times in the first 7 years of our life, and we don't remember that. Secure and insecure attachment theory is done before the 3rd year of your life. If you're secure and insecure, that's by your parents. So if you knew if what was happening with your parents. Most people, 40% of the population is insecure attached. So they don't know what their parents would or wouldn't do when they were young. Would they scream or smile? Would they say yes or would they say no? So based on that we didn't know, we created avoidant. Later in life, when we start working, we use justice, what is right, what is wrong, the rules, experience, and we can declare that. That's actually guiding all of us. We all have it somewhere. And that is what makes us communicate, present, and look how we look. And this morning I thought, oh, I'm going to be here, going to be filmed. Let's wear a polo. Why? Because the shirt I wanted to wear was a little bit different. I thought, oh, that will not look good on the camera. How do I know? Because somewhere down there, I was taught in Europe, a polo at least looks a little bit decent. Don't wear just a t-shirt, Chris. So I changed differently. But we can change it extremely fast and quick. So how can you change? The topic can change my mind power. I just come home, I can change my polo within 2 seconds. Well, then, I'm not so fast anymore. If you like to go down, talk therapy, counseling, psychology, NLP, you can work extremely good on the things you can still remember. Of course, you can talk about it, you can remember it, you can declare it. The moment you really like to have change in different kind of parts you cannot declare, I would say living your potential, one of the workshops I do, or hypnotherapy. Why hypnotherapy? Because it works on the part that cannot talk. You can call it subconscious. Not because I like to sell it, because I do everything, but I just came aware it's the best thing that ever happened. When I look at my clients, we're totally messed up when they come in and extremely happy when they walk out. We can change. Yeah. And if we... Our self-regulation depends on having a friendly relationship with ourselves. If not, we need something else. Source Bishop van der Kolk. I have to put there. This is what I do more. If you like to know more, booth 92. I'm dyslexic, so I turn on the things 92, somewhere there. Hypnotherapy. If not, I speech to you because I think we should end somewhere.
Thank you, Chris. Could everyone give Chris a huge round of applause? And I think the happiness register probably went up for a few of us, and we probably scored a little bit higher because he introduced such fabulous humour through the learning. So that was fantastic. So a huge applause for Chris.
Thanks so much. And if you have questions, I'm still downstairs. We can have a private talk or whatever.